Well, good morning. I'm Matthew West. I'm the technical lead for the National Digital Twin Programme. I think I'm talking to you about the IMF. Both looking at the change that the IMF implies at a macro and microeconomic level, and then also trying to look at the value of data and data integration, and look at just look at this is for, I've been looking at what's available and identifying what I think we need to, where we need to be able to get to with that. So it's some input for you on that. Let's just get into it, and we'll start with an introduction to the IMF. So when we look at the information management framework, we start with the seven circles of information management that we're dealing with. And we've got these seven circles. What characterizes a circle is that it's a major piece of the jigsaw in its own right. And has particular skills that are deployed at that level. And is supported by the levels beneath and supports the levels above. So at the top here we have, and generally speaking, as you go down through the levels, there are often dramatically smaller numbers of people involved in that level. So at the top level here we have information quality management, and this is managing information from day to day, looking at things like governance, roles and responsibilities, training, KPIs, all that kind of stuff. Which is about making sure that you have the information to support the decisions that are going on in your business. The next level down is getting the information requirements right. So it's about having your systematically identifying your information requirements by having a process model in place, down to the level where you can identify the decisions that are being taken and then establish the information requirements systematically from there, and then the quality requirements for that information. The next level down is the resources to enable secure sharing of data, our integration architecture, and this will be the open software that moves the data from where it's created to where it's needed. So how we actually share the data. Then the next level down is the industry data models and reference data. And this is the common language used by an industry or sector, or indeed across industries and sectors. And then the foundation data model. These are the common patterns to integrate data across industries. The top level ontology, are the fundamental categories of what exists. Okay, so the core construction ontology is actually identifying what exists. One of the things that an ontology does is it's a theory of what exists and the rules that govern it. But you can only talk about the things that are in your ontology. So it's actually having a formal way of defining what it is that you can talk about. For the ontologies that we're defining here, and trying to make sure that that's as broad as possible, but at least you know if what you want to talk about is included in what we support. There we go. And then it's those four bottom layers that are the four dimensions, and governed by the four dimensionalism gives it the rigor that is needed, so that you're not just having to sew together different views from different places. Of course, that's just the start. That's just the technical part of it. In order to make anything happen, you need to have management and support. And here we have the information management landscape, which is what an organization needs to put in place in order to support a quality management system for their information. And that starts with governance and organization, policy and controls framework, strategy and operating model, the plans and justifications for what you're doing. key performance indicators so that you know how well you're doing it and how you're improving. Roles and responsibilities, communication, then on the support, you've got a community of practice, knowledge management to capture that, training to provide people with the skills they need, and then your application portfolio and IT support for managing your information. And then if that's what an organisation needs to put in place, then the information management framework are the standards, guidance and common resources to support the development of consistent information management landscapes that can seamlessly share data. And a good chunk of that are those four lower circles from the reference data, foundation data model, ontology and core constructional ontology that provide that common basis for information. And of course, the integration architecture, which provides the software. But there's also guidance around all the elements of the management and support circle about how to actually do that and how to build up your information management maturity so that you can put all this in place. Just looking at the roles, here you see the different roles you get at these different levels, which is one of the way that that you distinguish between the circles, is that you have different skills and different roles at play there, both at the information management landscape level and at the industry management framework level here. Also at the outer levels, you have those people who are going to be involved at sector and company level for the management part of it, for an information management landscape. Then of course we eat our own dog food, so the information management framework is itself some information that needs to be managed, and that indeed needs to have the management and the support for the way that it's developed. Okay, so that's that first section. Are there any questions on that?
I haven't seen any question in the chat.
I would have to get out of here to see anything. Okay, well, if that was clear enough, then let's move on to, is it the change overview next?
Yes.
Okay, let's look at the change overview then. So when we look at levels of adoption, adoption means establishing an IMF compliant information management landscape for some information requirement. It might not be all the information in an organization. It might, for example, just be the information that they're sharing with others. But there are levels of adoption. But in each case, you're establishing an information management landscape. It might be at an organizational level, so a company, a government department, an NGO, whatever. At a sectoral level, so rail, water, power, that's normally going to be at a regulator level, a regulator requiring sharing of data to support industry level regulation. It might be at a national level, for example, to support cross-sector disaster response. And it might be at an international level, so looking at climate change, COVID-19, international trade. And so on. So, but in each case, essentially what you're doing is establishing an information management landscape. And as long as it's IMF compliant, then the idea is that you would be able to share data with others that were IMF compliant. So, if you're organizing your information at an organizational level, the information that you share with an information management landscape that's IMF compliant, that, for example, would be able to feed into a sectoral level information management landscape that was collecting data from you at a sector level. And then we have adoption in government and industry. So The way that we see that happening is about engaging with the IMF community. So those are the people who are looking to develop their information management landscapes. You need to establish the business case for action, establish governance for information management, establish the skilled resources to develop and implement an information management landscape, establish an information management landscape that's based on the, not just any old one, but one based on the IMF. That needs to be operationalized, and then you measure and improve your performance. And this is, so there's a two-stage process here. What you're trying to do is get to a place where, so there's a step change, which is establishing an improvement process for the management of information within your organization by developing a quality management system. And then there's operationalizing and using that quality management system to drive continuous improvement, which is the process you're trying to set up. So there's a step change followed by continuous change is the key thing to that. And indeed, the information management maturity model, which Anne will share with you, sort of takes you through that process of getting up the information management maturity levels to where you have that quality management system for information in place and in use to the level where you are improving, you are in a continuous improvement stage. Okay, so again, any questions about that? And presumably nothing in the chat either.
No, I can't see anything.
That's fine. We'll keep going then. When we're looking at macroeconomic change, we're really talking about putting the information management framework in place. So the obvious question is why isn't there already an information management framework? Surely if this was so useful, someone would already have created it. And the problem is that it's a public good. So it's in no one's interests to develop it because as soon as someone else does, you can just piggyback on what they've done. And that's classically the kind of situation where you see market failure and the need for government to intervene to put in place what's necessary. And of course, no one misses that it's not there because it doesn't affect competitiveness, its absence. It's only introducing it that has an impact on competitiveness because those who adopt it early will get a competitive advantage. But as long as it's not there, everyone's got the same level playing field. And again, just understanding that, part of being a public good is it's non-excludable. Anyone can use it once created, and it's non-rivalness. It can be used without being depleted, and these are the classic things that make a public good. It requires a governance structure to be effective. So just that it's there doesn't mean that it works because you have to use it consistently. It's key. There's no benefit to there being two IMFs. That just means that there are two ways of doing the same thing. And then if people have picked one or the other, then you have to find a way of bringing those together. And it needs to be with the interests of all users and potential users in mind, not just with the first guys that get onto the playing field. So the market needs enabling by appropriate government intervention at a macroeconomic level. And that's the change. So it needs a macroeconomic change to enable the market. So again, we need to establish the business case for action, and you can argue that's been done to a fair extent. We need to establish the governance for the IMF and its improvement, establish collaborative relationships with key players in government and industry, establish the information management framework itself, establish the legal framework for data sharing. We know that's a problem because you should just talk to anyone that's been involved with Credo Demonstrator. Establish a learning community for IMF users supported by a knowledge base of lessons learned and best practice, and develop the skills needed to develop and deploy the information management framework and measure and improve the performance, both of the IMF itself and those where it's deployed, for the development of the IMF and for the way that it's deployed to develop as the core for information management landscapes that organisations develop. So, did I just skip over something there, or is that right? Let's just go back one again.
That's okay.
So, in establishing the business case for action, one of the key things to note is the costs of enabling the market are modest relative to the total cost benefits of managing information. So we're looking at something that's of the order of tens of millions of pounds per annum for establishing and running an information management framework. And that means, by the way, that it's, you know, definitely more than £1 million per annum, definitely less than £100 million per annum. And probably, you know, closer to 10 million than either of those. So total costs of the national digital twin by comparison are likely to be billions of pounds per annum. This is looking at the total cost of information, so not taking account of the fact that some of that money would be spent anyway. Most of that money would probably more would be spent anyway without the information management framework. The idea of the information management framework is that it makes creating that information and sharing it cheaper rather than more expensive. But that's what is spent. And that's largely based on, if you look at what the cost of major infrastructure projects are, so this is really the construction phase, then, you know, something like 15% of that is the cost of design, and the design is just creating information. And then you can think about what it costs to operate the infrastructure and the cost of creating the information in that, which is probably more than that, probably more than the cost of creating it, certainly over the lifetime, which is some 25 years. So, but then what is that per annum? My estimate is that it's of the order of billions of pounds per annum spent creating the information that's needed. So the benefits, and the question is, by how much can we reduce that cost or improve the benefits that are from using that information? Two areas. So benefits are likely to be around double the costs or more. It would not be hard for that to be the case. So it's not really hard to see the potential for the information management framework to deliver really quite significant benefits, it seems to me, just on this back of the envelope kind of approach. Risks of technical failure are relatively low. We know how to do it. Adoption failure for organisations, I think that's a medium risk. It's interesting that what we're seeing as we reach out to industry, and again, particularly our experience from Credo, is that organisations, on the whole, understand that there is a problem, but actually also understand that they don't really know how to solve it and that they're likely to need help. But it's likely to be, you know, it's not a quick activity, it's not a quick fix. Market failure is a risk, and that could be as much that government don't recognise the value in doing this. But equally, if we fail for some reason, the only thing it really means is that we have to regroup and try again and try and understand why it failed. Because the problem's not going to go away. And what's happening, what I notice at the moment, because I've been working on this kind of stuff for at least 30 years, is that there is, what there is growing awareness at all levels that this is something that needs to be addressed. So I'm pretty confident that about that last bit, that if we fail for some reason, it only means that we need to regroup and try again. So no certainty about what we're doing, but no, I think we're in a relatively good position to take this forward. Okay, so now the last thing is looking at the value of data and data integration. We're looking at the benefits. So I've been, one of the things that you should do, if you haven't already done, is read Infonomics, which looks, sort of bemoans that data isn't treated by accounting folks as an asset, and sets about trying to encourage people to sell their data. And I thought that was really interesting, because on the right here, what you get are values of information that you can identify. So the first one is the cost, which is the usual accounting of the resources used to identify what data costs. And by the way, this doesn't normally happen. Normally the cost of data is built into the cost of the activity that probably accidentally created the data. So you'll have costs against the design of a building, but not costs against creating the data, which is really what that is. So as I was saying earlier, the cost of the design, I mean, the design is the data, but it's not treated. It's treated as if the design is something else, not the data, but that's really what it is. And we don't typically account for the cost of data, and we need to rather more. If it's an IoT system of some sort that's creating a digital twin, that's the basis for a digital twin, what's the cost of creating that digital twin there in terms of the IoT devices, the resources they need to operate, and so on and so forth. So the next thing is the value realized. And this is the value from the use you are making of the data that you have. That's, I'm kind of talking about that a bit on the left. The value comes from the decisions that it supports. I think that's fine. But what's the benefit? The benefit is what would be the alternative value if you didn't have the information? And so we're talking about taking decisions. So we're talking about the risks of making a mistake rather than making an optimal decision, so that's really what happens. And how do you calculate what the risk is? Well, you can look at the current situation and see what level of mistakes are happening, and these can start, you know, from over-ordering paperclips through to something like the Grenfell Tower disaster. One of the secrets here is to understand that pretty much anything that goes wrong is because someone made a decision that was a mistake, and they probably didn't make a mistake deliberately. Almost certainly they made a mistake because they didn't have the information they needed to make the right decision. Now, sometimes by blind luck, even when you don't have the right information, you're going to make the right decision, and that may be because you've seen that kind of situation lots of times before and you've got a good sense of which way to go, it might not be, certainly you're looking at it being riskier when you don't have the information that you need than when you do have the information. So trying to quantify that, what's the risk and what's the cost consequence of that risk, you know, as a percent on a percentage basis. And as I said, that can be from as little as over-ordering paper clips, and probably most mistakes are in that tail, the Amazon tail, if you like. But you do get these huge disasters like Grenfell Tower, where the cost is billions. Never mind the lives lost. But in addition to the lives lost, and that's going to cost to sort out. But that's even quite clearly recognised as an information management disaster, really. And identifying the golden thread is one of the things that's come out of that, which I think is wholly to the good. But you can see both how, if that golden thread had been in place, it would have been much harder for the probably fraudulent and possibly criminal decisions to be made, because the light would have been shone on them, through to things like the next day people wanted to know which other buildings had the same cladding, and if we'd had a national digital twin, so all the building regulations and planning data was available as data, you know, according to a common data model and reference data library, then rather than it taking 3 months to discover which other buildings have the same cladding, it would have taken a matter of hours to do so. So you can see that, again, at two levels, both in responding to a disaster, that you could have done a much better job, and that you could probably have prevented the disaster just by the quality of information, by the information being available and at the right quality, so that it couldn't be fudged and misused. So, and then you have the potential value, and this is the value you're missing. The data that you have that is not being used where it could be, and the unmet, possibly unknown information requirements, both inside and outside your organisation, missing information that you don't know is missing, even perhaps, or people outside don't know they could be using it for. So an example of that could be that you've got maintenance information on the equipment that you have, but that could be very valuable to the equipment manufacturer for improving their design, but that's unrealized, unrecognized on both sides. That there's potential value there. And then finally, there's the asset stripper's value. And this is, if a company went bust, what could you sell that information for to competitors, for instance? One of the things that's interesting is that one of the reasons that information isn't shared, all information isn't just open, is that it has commercial value to keep it secret. You know, for instance, who are my customers? What is their sales value? What is it that they're buying from me? All this kind of stuff is stuff that would be valuable to my competitors, but I particularly don't want to share. But once the company's gone bust, then an accountant who was liquidating the company might well be able to realize some value for that information. So that's the asset stripper's value for information. Okay, so if that's those are the different values that you can put on information, and I think it's really good to be able to think actively about all of those. Where do you get the benefits from quality information? Okay, so this is on the left. So automation. If you've got good quality information and it's data, you can automate deterministic processes. These are processes that you have sufficient understanding that you can say deterministically how decisions should be made given the appropriate input data. This both reduces costs because it takes people out of the loop, It can speed things up as well, so that's the process intensification. And it's quite common for there to be disruption. The kind of thing, story I tell is about how when I started work, we would communicate with people things that we wanted to put on the record. So, you know, you would write a note, it would go to the typist pool, they would type it up and send it back to you. You'd correct it, they'd retype it with the corrections. Then you'd photocopy it, highlight different copies that were going to go to different people and put it in your out tray, and then it would go. Now today, of course, I'd just send an email. That process, by the way, would take about a week. The email happens, I'm doing dozens of emails a day. That's where you get some intensification from, for instance, but also disruption, because we just work in a completely different way. There are no typists anymore. The whole process has just been hugely disrupted by the introduction of email. So there are reduced costs. You'll just be able to use the information provided to you rather than having to fix it up first. And the risk of making mistakes will be reduced because your decisions are better informed. Those are things that happen. Then there are benefits. Understanding remaining uncertainty in decisions. You'll have greater agility because you can anticipate disruptions and pivot to take advantage of them. You'll have better insights into your operations and assets, and this will enable innovation. You'll have the confidence that comes from knowing you're in good shape rather than hoping you are. And you may well recognize that you have something of value to others, as in that example I was talking about, you know, equipment maintenance data being valuable to the equipment manufacturer. So those are the key things that I think we need to start looking at for where the mechanisms are for how benefits are delivered. And that's what I hope that people who are working on the benefits side will pick up on and dig into to get into how we can do that, systematically identify the benefits and systematically plan to achieve them. Okay, that was it.